Okay, so most of the quarter, we've talked about tools and techniques for spotting bullshit for you. We've talked about ways in which bullshit comes in veiled in visualizations, in statistics, in algorithms. But in this section, I want to talk a little bit about refuting bullshit for others. It's hard enough to spot bullshit for yourself. This is difficult to do. It takes practice. This is even more difficult. On the first one, we talked about the importance of doing that in regards to Branelini's asymmetry principle. So if we could stop bullshit in its tracks, that's going to, you know, help solve a lot of the problem because it takes an order of magnitude more to clean it up. But what do we do when it gets out there? What happens when our friends, our colleagues, our family, or other community members in which we live believe in some myth that we're pretty sure is wrong? What do we do now? So how do we learn to refute bullshit for others? There was a nice set of readings that was put together by Cook and Lewandowski about the debunking handbook. And this reading just gives me a quick chance to say you can continue to follow our readings after the class, but it won't be updated on Canvas. We'll be updating it on the callingbullshit.org. So if you want to follow us there, we'll continue to add readings. Feel free to follow us on Twitter, and you can find some of the entertainment that we're having in debunking things that land in the news daily. So feel free to follow us there. But this is the reading that we assigned for today. One of the big take-homes in this reading is that people are not hard drives. If there is a myth that's believed, you can't just shove more information into that brain, into that human. And a lot of that is due to the complex cognitive processes that sort of govern how we think and how we behave.
And how dead salmons do.
And how dead salmons do as well. So when you're, you know, a lot of scientists think that they believe in this sort of information deficit model, which I think is wrong, and also the authors in here think is wrong, that if you just give more information, you'll be able to debunk these myths that exist. But it's not really the case most of the time. There's been several studies that have shown that even when you correct misinformation, once something had settled in the brain, it's really hard to overcome that. So there was a study that's well known from the Journal of Experimental Psychology where they explained they talked about a scenario of a warehouse fire and what the causes were for that particular fire. And they mentioned paint cans and various other things several times at the beginning. And then they corrected later and they said, actually, it has nothing to do with the paint cans. And then they return a little bit later and they start talking about other things that were found in the fire. And they ask the people in the experiment to explain what happens. And invariably, paint cans come back up because that's sort of what's in their brain. So the one thing that they found, one of the big things that they found out, and that many other studies have found out, is that you really need to fill that gap with an alternative explanation. So in this case, they ran the experiment, and the alternative explanation for one group that they were testing, they said, well, it involves, you know, inhaler or lighter fluid or various other things. And if you would fill it in with a gap, then you can remember it more. The big thing about these kinds of myths is that they stick. They're really, really hard to release from our brains once they're stuck. And in fact, if you're not delicate when you address your friends or your colleagues or your family about myths that you want to discuss about, if you're not careful, you can have what's called a backfire effect. It's like quicksand. Actually, in trying harder and harder and pushing more information and more complex arguments at them, a lot of times you'll just keep sinking and sinking and actually sinking faster. This backfire effect has been shown in many studies and it's talked about in this handbook for debunking myths. So here's five things that I think comes out of this article and I think were really good and worth talking about. So first of all, focus on the core facts. Make sure, here's one of the real subtle things when you want to do this effectively, don't start with the myth. There's been plenty of studies that say that if you start with the myth, and then give the alternative explanation, or then give the facts, if you ask them 30 days later, or you look at these various results from these experiments, what are the people going to remember? They're going to remember even more the myth. So be careful about, make sure to focus on the facts. If you have to refer to the myth, if you have to refer to that myth because of the way that you're delivering your argument, proceed it with an explicit warning. Something like, you know, beware could be misleading information. The big thing, of course, of all of them is to make sure you fill it in with an alternative explanation. Of course, we're assuming, just like Carl said, that you're correct and that you have an alternative explanation. But be clear with that alternative explanation and be concise. This is something you can apply to various areas of your life, not just in bullshit calling. But more is not always better. There's an old acronym that maybe you've heard of before, KISS, Keep It Simple Stupid. And make sure if you use graphics and visualizations, but of course we're assuming you're going to do these graphics and visualizations in effective ways and you're going to do it right. If you do it right, study after study shows that as visual creatures, we're really a lot better at remembering these kinds of things. So let's go through an example, at least from this particular reading. You can see where the myth is sitting. The myth, just so you know, at least in this case, they're using this as an example, is that one of the most common and persistent climate myths is that the sun is causing global warming. And there's arguments, various places on the internet that the sun is getting hotter, and that the sun is maybe getting closer, which is why we might be seeing hotter temperatures. But the way that this argument is formed is you start with the core facts. Remember, you start with the core facts. Sun and climate are going in opposite directions right now. Actually, the sun is cooling slightly and the earth is warming. This is true. This isn't just a playful example. And then you can explain in more details if you need it. Over the last few decades of global warming, the sun has shown a slight cooling trend. Sun and climate are going in opposite directions, et cetera, et cetera. If you have to mention the myth, then you can explain how the myth is being misled. And again, you know, this climate example, this can apply to any kind of example. So in this case, the myth cherry picks the data showing past periods when sun and climate did actually move together. There are times when it's moved together, but ignoring the last few decades when the two have been diverging. Now, make sure you rebut or refute. There is a difference between rebutting an argument and refuting an argument. Refuting argument focuses on the facts and evidence. That's generally the way that you sort of start. Rebutting is a little more complicated in that you're sort of changing the overall explanation, the sort of worldview of whatever myth you're attacking or argument. But do it at your own risk. I like this. For those skiers out there, you'll see these different levels. There's advanced, intermediate, and basic. If you can keep your argument on the basic runs, you're going to do much better. And again, the reason why you do that is because the backfire effect really sort of gets in the way again. As you get more complicated with your explanations, the more that people start to tune out and start to think about what they already believe. So this is an example that goes the whole way through, you know, talking using a visualization, mentioning at the very top, so the core facts communicated are at the very top, that's reinforced in the opening paragraph. That's, you know, you can basically show here, a little extra detail based on the statement above. That's what you want people to see first. The one thing I will say about this sort of debunking arguments, it can be used nefariously too. I mean, you can use these techniques as ways of refuting things that aren't right, so please don't do that. There you see the myth, it's sitting way down here if you have to mention it. In this case, they're talking about this OISM petition project that claims that 31,000 scientists disagree with the scientific consensus on global warming. Explained here is that, however, around 99% of the scientists listed in the petition project are not climate scientists. That's what you could use here. The petition is open to anyone with a Bachelor of Science or higher and includes medical doctors, mechanical engineers, and computer scientists, which may not have the same knowledge that a climate scientist does. So this is sort of a set of techniques. Again, you get better at this. And this, again, is in this realm of trying to debunk misinformation that's already out there, which is even more difficult than refuting for yourself or spotting bullshit yourself.